Mount Vernon, the home of George Washington. A two-year groundbreaking investigation is underway, merging forensic science and history. The mission, to turn a myth into a man. For over two centuries, George Washington's true likeness has been buried under an avalanche of iconic images. From the dollar bill to President's Day sales, from portraits to statues, his face has probably been reproduced more than any other in American history.
People look at the dollar bill image and say George Washington was old, he was stiff, he was formal.
Washington is kind of a uniform or a presidential suit, a withered face, and that's about it.
But under the mountain of distorted images, something has been lost. This is the story of a two-year investigation launched by Mount Vernon to solve the puzzle of who George Washington really was and what he really looked like.
The more you know Washington, the greater he becomes. The more he's humanized, the more you really appreciate, among other things, the extent of his sacrifice for this country.
This is not just a mythical, iconic figure, but in actual fact, a remarkable flesh and blood man who was able, despite all the difficulties he faced, achieve so much of what he set out to do.
As part of a fresh new look at George Washington, Mount Vernon has built a $60 million museum and education center. The capstone of this expansion is the creation of three life-sized figures that will be the most accurate and lifelike ever created of him.
In the 18th century, Washington was thought to be the action hero. He was the most athletic, the most adventurous, the best horseback rider, and that's very contrary to the image that most Americans have today.
He's the man without whom the United States could never have come into being. And yet, he was a man with flaws. He's somebody like us.
The first figure will depict Washington as a 19-year-old surveyor.
We try to pick a time in his life when he was becoming Washington, if you will. And I think that his first real job as a surveyor in the Western lands was a perfect choice for that.
He was the finest horseman of his generation, even as a young man. But at the same time, he was a kid, a naive kid.
The second figure will be the 45-year-old commanding general at Valley Forge.
It was the darkest time of the war. It was a time when the army was indeed on the verge of falling completely apart.
The third figure will be the 57-year-old man about to become the first president of the United States.
He couldn't, consistent with his sense of honor, refuse the universal call to serve. He's got a lot to lose and relatively little to gain.
Washington wasn't a great strategist. His tactics weren't that good. But even though he lost a lot more battles than he won, against all odds, Washington led this ragtag army to victory.
It was at Valley Forge during the brutal winter of 1777 and 78 that General Washington would encounter the turning point of his military career and the turning point of the Revolution.
It was a time when the Continental soldiers were doubting their own ability to win the war, when the soldiers were going through such intense suffering through lack of food, lack of suitable clothing, through disease, terrible weather. There were 10 to 12,000 soldiers, of whom 2,000 died of disease.
In the months preceding Valley Forge, Washington's troops in every encounter with the British, from Brandywine to Germantown, had been defeated. Some members of the Second Continental Congress thought Washington was incompetent and wanted to replace him as commanding general.
So Washington's really, at Valley Forge, he's under unbelievable pressure. Unbelievable pressure. And yet, he stayed there for the whole time, managing his army, keeping it together, to the point that Washington at Valley Forge earned not just the respect, not just the trust of his soldiers, but he earned the love of his soldiers, something he had never had before. At Valley Forge, Washington showed the most important thing is that he cared if they lived or died.
The situation of the Army is most critical and alarming. Many of the troops have not drawn the smallest supplies. They have been on the point of dispersing. The troops must have instant relief, or we shall have reason to apprehend the worst consequences.
It would be soon after his 57th birthday that Washington would face his greatest challenge as first president of the United States.
Washington was a lot more reluctant to be president than he was to be commander-in-chief of the Continental Army, because now he has the fame that he sought and desired. He is a lot older, 57, and he's from a short-lived family. He loves Mount Vernon. He had promised that he would leave power, and now he's going back into power, going back into a situation that's almost as difficult as winning the war to try to get the nation going on a proper footing.
He felt that public service was a duty that he had been called to by the nation, by Providence, as he called it. And he thought that a public-minded man who loved his country had no choice but to obey, obeying with all kinds of misgivings.
I assure you that my movements to the chair of government will be accompanied by feelings not unlike those of a culprit who's going to the place of his execution. Integrity and firmness is all I can promise.
Federal Hall had been New York City Hall. It's located in the heart of today's financial district. That day, there were 10,000 people standing outside Federal Hall. The president took the oath of office on April 30th, 1789. He went inside to the Senate chamber, and before a joint session of Congress, which was much smaller in those days, he read his inaugural address. There were Americans who were very suspicious of this new constitution and this elective king called a president, and Washington wanted to put them at ease. They didn't have to worry about him, at least, becoming a king any more than they had at the end of the Revolution when he had had a crown offered to him. He had voluntarily turned in his commission at the end of the Revolution. George III, otherwise no great admirer of his erstwhile subjects, said that if that was true, then Washington was the greatest man in the world.
They're very, very powerful. And one feels as if you were in the presence of the real man, which is just a hugely powerful experience.
Washington's greatest accomplishment was to redefine the meaning of greatness. Until Washington, to be great was to conquer, to acquire, usually through violence. Washington walked away from power voluntarily, twice, once at the end of the Revolution, and then, of course, at the end of his presidency.
We really would not be the United States of America if it weren't for Washington. There would have been no union for Lincoln and FDR to save if it hadn't been for Washington's charisma, leadership, and vision at the beginning of the nation.
Washington moved mountains, and his example deserves to live in a way that it can't live when it's imprisoned in marble. Washington is someone who speaks to us, or should, if we would only listen.
If we can see ourselves in George Washington, we can begin to understand what we are capable of as people, as Americans, as citizens of this country, and we can begin to see ourselves as the hope for the future.